It's wonderful to be here, and I really enjoy the discussions we have had here and we are still having. And I think it's very important to have these types of preliminary meetings. And I'm sure we will have other meetings both here and elsewhere. And I think what this tells us all is that this is an ideal preparation for the next stage where we are going to talk not only about theory, but we are also going to do some more practical aspects. I am a physicist by training, and in physics everything is based on theory and experiment. If you only do experiments, you don't even know what experiment to do, let alone what to make of it. If you only do theory, then it becomes armchair philosophizing and you lose touch with reality. So it is really important in physics or in science in general that you jump into the circle of theory and experiment. Experiments inspires new theory inspires further experimentation, and that way you keep moving around the circle and making progress. Mm-hmm. And I think that there are so many parallels between science and contemplation. Contemplation too has its laboratory. People meditate or pray or do other devotional or other forms of inquiry. Mm-hmm. And there is their laboratory. There are so many parallels with the scientific type of laboratory. Mm-hmm. Even though people classify contemplation as subjective and scientific as objective, really, if push comes to shove, both of them are intersubjective. In both cases, people compare in a group of peers with all the same training and same background. Mm-hmm. In a respectful atmosphere, they compare notes, they criticize each other, and they collaborate. Mm-hmm. And this combination of collaboration and competition, in some sense, mm-hmm. is what makes science progress. And if I get the impression correct, I think that is also what stimulates contemplatives when they talk with each other. Mm-hmm. So I think in a next round of these type of meetings, it is really important to get to this experimental stage and to divide the time up between theoretical experimental sessions and just an open dialogue to see how we can develop a new methodology which embraces both science and mm-hmm. contemplation. I think one of the reasons that the present meeting is going so well is, of course, it is partly the great preparation by Chris, who put everything together, and everybody else who participates. But I think in a larger scheme of things, the reason that everything is going so well here is simply timing. When I started getting interested in both science and contemplation, around the time that I was at the end of high school, early university studies, around 1970, at that time, it was completely unpopular, to say the least, to talk about consciousness or meditation or contemplation in science circle. Even in the 1980s, it was not done. You had to wash your mouth if you would talk about the word consciousness in a physics group. Which is strange, because the history of physics shows that many physicists were interested in philosophy and in wider questions. Mm-hmm. It was just that somehow the few decades after the Second World War, probably as a reaction to the German side losing and the German side having focused so much about romantic philosophy and other aberrations of philosophy, really, culminating in the worst way in the Nazi Germany period, mm-hmm. that people got suspicious of philosophy and for a few decades just did not want to hear about it. Fortunately, that period is now past, and in the late 80s, early 90s, suddenly, physicists and others started to talk much more freely about consciousness in science. Mm-hmm. And as a result, the climate has been changed quite a bit. The ground has been prepared throughout mm-hmm. the 90s. Mm-hmm. And now in the zeros, it seems we are really ready for a dialogue of this type. One of the interesting things in this meeting was to see how Western philosophers who were not familiar with Indian and Tibetan thought were frankly bowled over by the notion that Indian and Tibetan thinkers had thought so deeply about topics that they had have been thinking about their whole scientific career. I was familiar with many of these thoughts, including Dharmakirti, Nagarjuna, and many others. But I realized that most people are not. And it reminds me of a meeting I had in 1997 in the Ramsala, with the Dalai Lama and a number of other scientists, a number of other physicists, where I was the only one who was really familiar with Tibetan thought. And the other people also were really surprised how sophisticated the level of discussion was. They came there basically with the idea to, in a friendly way, entertain the natives, so to speak, but it was quite different than they expected. Concerning the question of the self-understanding of other cultures and the question of where we can meet on common ground or at some sort of in-between ground, that is the question which still has not been answered so far. We are meeting in an academic hall, in an academic place, in a university in the West, and we are talking about Tibetan and Indian ideas, but completely in a Western way, within a Western mode of speaking, within an academic discussion. Everything is squarely Western, and one of the tasks we have in the near future will be to create a new arena, a new stage to conduct a discussion which is more respectful for both cultures, not only the Western, not only Indian Tibetan, but really both. And this is the reason that in my talk I emphasized the experiential aspects, that in order to really talk about these topics, we have to leave behind both the conventional way of speaking and the scientific way of speaking, but we should get at least somewhat familiar with a more experiential way of engaging with the world in terms of presence, in terms of being, in terms of a no-self position. It is all very nice to talk about the Buddhist idea of no-self, but if you talk about it in an academic way in which you are very self-consciously giving a speech and squaring off with other selves around you, your way of speaking belies what you're talking about. And in order to really taste the notion of no-self, we need to do something different, and I expect that that will happen in the future. I mentioned my dialogue with the Dalai Lama and other physicists almost 10 years ago, and in that context I also heard about the Science for Monks program, which seemed to have started around that time, which seems still to be going on. And I think that is wonderful, but I think that it's only one side of the coin. If we have a Science for Monks program, we also should have a Contemplation for Scientists right. program. And once we have both, then the scientists and the monks can talk. And then it is not so important whether the monks speak English very well. Then it's also not very important that the scientists don't speak Tibetan. On the level of contemplation, like people playing music together or doing sports together, they can meet in a way which does not have to be purely verbal. So once we get to that position, I think it will be more interesting also for the Tibetans and people from India and other cultures right. to engage, because they don't have to become a little scientist in a one-sided way. We all have to find a common ground where we meet. I think the most important aspect of these meetings is to reach young people. If I think about the way that I learned about this cross-cultural dialogue, I must say I got a very slow start. When I started in the early 70s, I had a few books about meditation, contemplation, but those books were really not good enough to give me a clear idea of what I should do myself. And I had nobody to talk to about these issues personally. There were not even teachers in Holland at that time. They came later in the 70s, but around 1970, occasionally somebody came for a weekend. And apart from that, I was just in a way at a loss. As an undergraduate, I did find one Roman Catholic priest who was already retired and who gave a little student discussion group where maybe half a dozen people came on medieval mystics. And that really opened my eye. And I realized how much there was in parallel between, for example, Dutch medieval mystic Ruysbroek, as well as others, who we were reading under his guidance with his personal instruction. And that gave me a sense of how universal contemplative insights were. I had just been reading books like The Three Pillars of Zen and other books about Zen, about Buddhism, about Hinduism, and to find such similar sensibilities in Rusbroek was very encouraging. But even then, during the 70s and later in the 80s, I found it very hard to make a connection between science and contemplation. It was in the early 90s, when I somehow stumbled on the philosopher Husserl, that I realized that there was a real stepping stone, a real bridge in principle between Eastern and Western thought. Husserl was a philosopher with a scientific background who had a more experiential approach. He had his own form of laboratory, it's called the epoche, looking at the world in terms of the way the world presents itself in consciousness, not doubting the world like Descartes, but just looking at the world as experience, and to try to taste the quality of experience independent of the other degrees of freedom. Science as well as philosophy is a matter of making distinctions and making clear distinctions and distinguishing different degrees of freedom, and Husserl was a master in that, and I found that very inspiring. So if I look at my own trajectory, it took me 35 years to come to the type of understanding I have right now. I have the feeling that young people should be able to get the gist of this in 5 or 10 years. They don't need to spend 35 years. Times have changed. There is a lot more information. There are people who have more experience now, and there are more opportunities. So the most important aspect of these meetings are to let young people get their toes wet, and hopefully more, get them to jump into this area while they are studying, hopefully at the end of high school already, certainly during their studies, so that by the time they finish their academic education, they get their PhD or whatever degree they get, that by that time they really have a feel for what it means to contemplate as well as what it means to do science. And then we can get a new generations or a generation of people which can conduct a real dialogue. Sometimes people ask me when I come to meetings like this about my choice to become a scientist, given that I have interest in contemplation as well. And yes, that is an interesting question. If I think about it myself, why did I make choices? Why did I become a scientist? Why did I do this or why did I do that? You can make all kind of stories about why you do things, but in the end, you do things because they feel natural, they feel the right things to do. I must say, at the end of high school, I did think about dropping out. I mean, this was in the late 60s after all, and dropping out was a normal phenomenon. I did think about the possibility of maybe moving to Japan and becoming a Zen Buddhist or whatever. I decided in the end not to do that because I thought, well, I have already a Western background, a Western education. If I can go on and become a scientist and then have a dialogue with Eastern ways of thinking, I can probably be more useful than by going there and trying to re-thread myself in a completely new way.